Welcome to another edition of the East Ward Update. I'm Councilmember Derwin Montgomery, and on today's show, we'll have the City of Winston-Salem City Manager and one of the newest members of the City Manager's team. As well, we'll be discussing some of the City of Winston-Salem's capital needs and what it means for us to be able to dive in deep to take care of some of our capital needs here at the City of Winston-Salem. So join us. We're joined here today with the man that runs things here around the City of Winston-Salem. We call him the City Manager, and that's Mr. Lee Garrity. Mr. Garrity, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us a little bit about the Manager's office and the role of the City Manager in your office.
Sure. Council Montgomery, years ago, the City Manager form of government was created as a way to have a little facilitation between your elected officials and your professional staff. My job is to carry out the policies that you, the council, and the mayor make. You set the policies, you decide which way city council wants the city to move, and then you expect your manager and then all the staff to carry out those jobs. So yes, I'm the CEO, but council is the board of directors.
But so you're the one that makes it all happen. So you take the orange juice and the sugar and you put it all together and the lemonade and you make a little blend to make it all happen.
That's true. I'm the one that you expect to carry it out. And if it doesn't go the right way, you're gonna hold me accountable, which is the way that the job is created. I also, just like I said, am the facilitator. So working with the whole council to work then with professional staff to try to make sure that the desires of the council and the electorate that elects the council gets carried out.
And so your job is, I would consider to be cumbersome in the sense of how large of a organization the City of Winston-Salem is. Some people don't understand how large of an organization it is. How many different areas do you supervise?
It's a large organization, 2,500 personnel. And $300 million budget, but I only have about 7 direct reports. Fortunately, I am blessed to have good staff who make sure that the trash is picked up and the money's balanced and that law enforcement takes care of things. But it's a large operation down the line.
And those 7 reports, what areas are those?
I have 3 assistant city managers. I have police and fire, and then human resources. Am I leaving something out? And the chief financial officer. So finance, budget, 8 human resources, but the line operations are carried out by those 3 assistant city managers. So one of them handles basically your public works services, one handles financial issues and a lot of our internal functions, and the third really is our community and economic development director.
Okay, so let's move to that second one you just mentioned about, and I think we may have that person okay. Close. So would you introduce us to?
Sure, this is Ben Rao. He's the most recent appointee as an assistant city manager. He's been with the city for 16 years.
Yes.
And formerly was the budget director. And in his new roles, he still is responsible for the budget office as well as all of our property and building maintenance functions as well as our IT, our computer systems. And I'm probably leaving some more stuff out, Ben.
Public assembly
facilities, convention center, Bowman Gray Stadium, fairgrounds.
All right. Well, welcome, Ben. We're happy, one, to have you here, but more so happy to have you in your new role that you're in now. And just tell us a little bit about yourself. And I know you said you've been with the city for 16 years and now transitioning into this position.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Councilmember Montgomery. I joined the city in 1996 as a budget and evaluation analyst. And worked in there and kind of rose through the ranks, if you will, becoming a senior analyst at one point and then the deputy budget director, served in that role for a good number of years, and then about 2 years ago became the budget evaluation director. So I've been in the budget shop for all my career since graduate school. I'm a graduate of Wake Forest University. Also earned my master's degree in public administration from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. And so, but as the manager said about a year ago, became one of the assistant city managers.
All right, sounds good. Well, we're truly blessed to have both of you all here working in the City of Winston-Salem because as a council member, I understand and know that as Mr. Garrity said before, as we make the policy, we don't necessarily carry out the actual implementation of the policy. And it takes good people and good staff to be able to carry out the policy that's made at the council level. But then also being able, willing to listen to staff and staff recommendations in terms of the information that's there. So it's always great to make sure that we have great staff that's working towards the better good of the citizens of Winston-Salem. Well, again, we thank you for being here and introducing yourself to the citizens of Winston-Salem. We know that you all, both of you all, will be continuing to do a great job here for the city. We'll be joined here in just a second by these two gentlemen again as we continue to talk about some of the things that the city of Winston-Salem needs to take care of, particularly what we call capital needs.
This is the Winston-Salem Police Department telling you that we have implemented a strategic plan to combat texting while driving. We want our residents to remain safe while on our roads and highways. One text or call could wreck it all.
Dirty Bird.
Dirty Bird, don't dump waste into the stream. This is Lenny the lifeguard saying, hop to it, protect our water.
Welcome back. So, as we discussed before, we were talking about some of the areas that the city manager's office takes care of, and then we moved a little bit to introducing you and your area of focus. And so one thing that we've been looking to you for here recently and some conversations that have been taking place are around capital needs. And either one of you can answer it, but in terms of capital needs, what are capital needs?
Well, capital needs would be major expenditures in the infrastructure of the city. So for example, road improvements, street resurfacing, the construction of new facilities, be it recreation facilities, recreation amenities, fire stations. So really sort of investments in the city's infrastructure.
And so as we look at our city now, and we've been updated on some of the numbers that we see now in terms of some of the costs to take care of some of our capital needs, why are we where we are right now when it comes to our capital needs?
Well, over the last several years, Councilman Montgomery, there's been a number of needs that have been identified both by the City Council as well as a Citizens Capital Needs Committee that the Council appointed back in 2011. Even citizens have given us feedback over the years. In addition to that, the City Council has adopted a number of planning documents, the Legacy 2030 plan, the long-range transportation plan, a number of planning documents that have also recommended some investments in the community. And altogether, all those needs that we've identified total over $709 million.
And so as we look at that $700 million worth of pent-up capital needs that you know, we see every day as we drive on our roads, we go to our parks, we see the need for some investment just to maintain. And some of the reason that that number has continued to grow that high is because as we look at where we've been over the last several years in the economy, some of those maintenance items have been deferred and have not been taken care of in order for us to continue to look at balancing the budget and maintaining a lower tax rate than many of the surrounding cities and cities in the state. And so because of that, we've seen some of our infrastructure kind of go down a bit, but now we see an opportunity for us to make an investment in those, correct?
And that is correct. That is correct. You're exactly right. Since the recession of 2008, we have had to defer maintenance on some of our facilities, and so those are also among the capital needs that we've identified.
And so in the past, how have the cities and cities like ours taken care of some of these type of major infrastructure improvements? How do we pay for that kind of work?
Well, in other cities in North Carolina, and particularly when we look at the large cities, Charlotte, Durham, Greensboro, and Raleigh, they have held what are called bond referenda, where they actually go to the voters and ask them to approve issuing a certain amount of debt with bonds to in order for them to pay for those major investments in the community.
And as we look at bonds, and when people hear bonds, they sometimes attach that directly with their taxes. Is there a connection there?
There can be. And what we're doing here in the city is looking at what our debt capacity is, and we know how much new debt that we can take on without having an impact on the tax rate. The conversations that the city council has is in the process of having looking at a number of bond packages that could have an impact on the tax rate, depending on the size. In particular, at the most recent capital needs workshop, looked at a $125 million and a $200 million bond financing scenarios that would have an impact on the tax rate. The $125 million would require a 1.5-cent increase in the tax rate, and the $200 million package would require a 3.5-cent increase.
And so right now, the city council and staff are in the beginning stages of these conversations. And as we continue to move forward with these kind of conversations, as you stated, some of the things we've looked at right now include either a $125 million bond or a $200 million bond, or we could find ourselves somewhere in between all of that. And so as we move forward, what are some of those items, those big ticket items that are within the actual documents that we've been looking at?
Yes, sir. Well, it crosses a number of service areas. So we're looking at community and economic development, public safety, recreation, transportation, even investments in our convention center. In the area of community economic development, we're looking at investments in our downtown, for continued development of our downtown area. Also, funds to help with the development of future business parks or other economic development sites and infrastructure. Also, investments in our neighborhoods through investments in public infrastructure, providing funds for housing rehabilitation, those types of investments. In public safety, looking at doing some major renovations to a few of our fire stations, continued development of the Al Beatty Public Safety Training and Support Center, provide more space for forensic services and training. Also, investments in the construction of three police district facilities. In recreation, in the recreation area, the City Council approved a number of master plans here in recent months. And so in both of those packages, there would be investments to at least carry out initial phases of those master plans. And so that would include Winston Lake Park, Salem Lake Park. Also, the package would include some investments in Winston Lake Golf Course and further renovating the sand traps and the overall course. And then under transportation, you have street resurfacing, new sidewalk construction, sidewalk repairs. Again, a lot of maintenance, major maintenance for our transportation system, road widenings, those types of investments. And then finally, with the convention center, it would be implementing some of the recommendations from a facility assessment that took place a couple of years ago that recommended some major renovations to help improve the marketability of the convention center. So some of those recommendations are included in the packages.
So it sounds like a whole lot, but when you look at the rest of the capital needs that are not included in that, this kind of just takes a chunk out of that big thing, but it still leaves a whole lot that needs to be done over as we look into the future.
Yes, sir.
And so as we look at this and we look at our timelines and timetables, actually shifting a little bit, Mr. Garrity, when you think about the need of a bond, what is your thoughts on that, the need of a bond or just the need to take care of capital needs?
We have not had a bond referendum since 2000. All the other cities in North Carolina have had multiple bond referendums in the last 6 to 8 years. So we really are at a critical point where we have that need. And general obligation bond financing is the most cost-efficient way, the lowest interest rate. So it is the wise, prudent way to invest in our infrastructure. So I think we are at a point where we really need to work hard to explain to all of our citizens what the needs are and why it's important that we issue these bonds.
Right. And many citizens, you know, they see and see things that are in need of being repaired and taken care of. And they call us all the time in terms of, you know, trying to see how do we get these things taken care of, but don't always understand that there's a huge list that encompasses things from across the entire city that have great needs, and the need that they call in about is no less important as some of those things that we have already heard about. But as we look at the packages that we have that lists that $700 million worth of capital needs that needs to be taken care of, it's a sense of how do we take care of it? How do we actually get the dollars that's necessary to do it? If you can explain a little bit the difference in, I know we talk about bonds, but the difference in terms of financing some of those things, because I think we'd be looking at something a little bit different at the convention center than we would be looking at with some of the other capital improvement needs.
Yes, Council Montgomery, there are several ways to finance capital needs. We try to do a little bit with what we call PAYGO, which is pay as you go, a little bit of your reserves. Obviously, we don't have $700 million of reserves that we could spend, but we try to do a little bit of small things that are real critical to get done quickly. And then really the other two options are general obligation bonds, which go to the voters, have the lowest interest rate, and what we call limited obligation bonds, which is basically a little different in that it's basically a mortgage on your asset. So we are looking at the potential for the convention center to do a new mortgage if you would have us refinance the debt on the convention center, just like you would on your house when you need to refinance it so you can redo your roof and do some those kind of things. It's a little different structure for financing because instead of pledging the full faith and tax credit of the city government, you're pledging that asset like a mortgage. So for the convention center, we may look at doing that way, do it a little quicker. You got some critical needs there if we want to continue to attract conventions and tourists to Winston-Salem.
And staying on that sense of the convention center, just as a example of why it's important to make those investments, when you're looking at the convention center, that is a large draw for the city. It has a great impact on downtown, but not just downtown, but on the entire city of Winston-Salem, from bringing conferences and institutes into the city, and having a facility that's available to individuals who want to plan conferences and want to have events is important for any thriving city. Is that not right?
That's correct. Any city of any size really has to have a convention center. It is the biggest draw, the number one draw that brings people downtown to the restaurants, to the hotels. The convention center is kind of critical to our economic vitality of downtown.
And so, again, in terms of keeping up and maintaining those items, it's just like maintaining our roads. When we think about what we call infrastructure, which includes our road systems, the roads are there to help people get to their jobs, to help logistically with goods being taken from one place to another. And if your roads aren't in good shape and you're unable to allow for this traffic to get from point A to point B, it really affects the overall picture of your local economy. And so each one of those things that we see on our capital needs, in my opinion, have a way, when you put them all together, at looking at the economic vitality of our city, as well as the wellness of the people and quality of life items that you look at for people in the city of Winston-Salem. And it takes investment to keep those things up. It takes taking care of it and looking at how you can continue to improve those things. And so as we look further down the road and looking at our capital needs, I know that we're some distance away from getting to a document that we're going to send to community if we at all decide to do a bond. And I know that there's a whole nother conversation that has to be had around the bond referendum. But Ben, if you would just enlighten us just a little bit on the timetable that Council is working on to continue to look through these capital needs, because it's important that we take the time to look at what we're actually wanting to take care of, because out of $700 million, there are a lot of things in there, and so we're only going to be able to take a swing at a portion of that. And so moving forward, how are we going to move forward with this?
Yes, sir. Well, the City Council held its capital needs workshop last month. I believe that they're going to hold another Committee of the Whole meeting here perhaps later this month to further discuss the list and refine the list. And I believe in April, I think that one possibility is for the city to hold community meetings to go out into the community and provide information about what is in the proposed packages, simply to continue to get feedback, to inform the citizens about what the potential costs would be with these particular scenarios. And then the goal is to bring to the City Council in May our six-year capital improvement plan, our CIP, that would include the projects that it appears the council may want to include in a potential bond referendum. So that document would be reviewed by the City Council and then approved. And then in June really starts the timetable for actually scheduling a bond referendum. There's a number of steps that have to be taken in terms of public notices, in terms of actually making a final decision on which projects would be included in a bond referendum. And that would happen throughout the summer, the June, July, August months, all with the goal of setting the bond referendum for November 4th of this year.
Okay, so that's a jam-packed year in terms of looking at how we take care of capital needs. But I think that the citizens of Winston-Salem want to see some investment in much of our infrastructure across the city. And just again, to paint that picture for people out there, that what we're talking about is improving on things that you see every single day. We're talking about your roads. We're talking about the parks that you go to. We're talking about public safety. We're talking about the opportunity to expand some of our public safety more centrally located in our city. We're talking about fire stations. We're talking about many things that sometimes we don't pay attention to, but that are vital to the operations of our city government. And it's going to be important, and I'm glad that you talked about the point in terms of those community meetings, because it's going to be very important for the citizens to participate in this conversation and this dialogue. That council cannot unilaterally have a conversation amongst ourselves, nor can staff, but it has to be a dialogue that happens council, staff, and community all at the same time, having a conversation about these items, because at the end of the day, if we decide to have a bond package, it's going to be the community that has to say, yes, this is what we want to do. These are things that we want to support to move forward with. And every one of the members of council can, you know, we can vie for our own special projects that are out there that we think will be great. But at the end of the day, it's going to be the community that's going to say, yes, we agree with you or we disagree with you. And these are the items that we think should move forward in community. So I'm glad that both of you all were able to come and talk a little bit about our capital needs, and glad that we were able to introduce you, Ben, to your new role here. Again, you're not new to the city of Winston-Salem, but in this new role that you have here, and hopefully that the community has been enlightened a little bit about some of the conversations that we've been having around capital needs and have a sense of our timeline moving forward. So I just want to say thank you both for taking the time to come on and share a little bit and have a conversation with the community.
Glad to be here.
Thank you, Councilman.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you again for joining us for another edition of the East Ward Update. You can find more information about the East Ward Update and many of our broadcasts that we've recorded in the past by visiting us at www.cityofws.org and clicking on our YouTube page, and you will find there more opportunities to view some of these broadcasts. Again, thank you for joining us for the East Ward Update.